Well, hello, everybody. My name is Rob Schenck, and I'm the Chief Content Officer for the National Medal of Honor Museum being built in Arlington, Texas. And I'm excited and honored to be here today with two people associated with Captain Stephen Bennett, one of 19 U.S. Air Force Medal of Honor recipients. So I'm here with Angela Bennett Engel, who was the daughter of Captain Bennett, and also Major Mike Brown of the United States Marine Corps, who was with Captain Bennett on that Medal of Honor flight back in June 29th, 1972. How are you both doing today?
Doing great.
Fantastic. Well, this is a historic day. We're talking on the 50th anniversary of this flight that earned the Medal of Honor for Captain Bennett. And maybe, Angela, since you're from the family, I'd love to know, and if you could share with the audience a bit more about your father, kind of where he was born, where he was, where he grew up.
Sure. Thank you for having us and for highlighting his service on the anniversary. He was born April 22nd, 1946 in Palestine, Texas. And within about 2 years, they moved from there to the Lafayette area, to the Youngsville-Broussard area of Louisiana. And he grew up there. So the states kind of argue over where he's from. It kind of depends on what the, you know, what the requirements are for whatever the memorial is. But if it's where he entered service, then that would be Louisiana. And if it's where he's born, then that would be in Texas.
And Angela, I understand that the city of Palestine actually just put up a memorial to your father there, right?
They did. Several years back, they had put up Stephen Bennett Park, and that was kind of part of like a YMCA type of a facility. And then just a few months ago, back in, I believe it was in March, maybe February, they erected a Texas State Historical Marker. So that was really special. And Mike was able to go to that as well. So they did put that up in Anderson County is the one that did that.
Would your dad have considered himself from Lafayette? Would he consider himself a Louisianian?
I think so. But I think having family still be here in Texas, because there's a lot of our family still in the Elkhart area of Texas. I think that they were very close to their family ties back here in Texas as well.
Now, Angela, I know you were a very young person, even a newborn, before your father went off to Vietnam. But what are some of the stories that you've heard about your father? What was he like? What can you share in terms of him as a young person?
I've always been told that he knew he wanted to be a pilot. He was always very patriotic. My grandmother on my mother's side used to tell me that if my dad didn't die the way that he ended up dying, he would have been killed helping an old lady cross the street. It's just kind of who he was. I've heard over and over and over again from people that knew him in high school or college, or even people from the military, and they would say things like they weren't surprised to hear that this had happened, that he had... he was in this situation because it's just kind of who he was. So I've also heard he was a practical joker at some points, and that he enjoyed swimming. He was he liked archery. He loved to play chess. So my grandmother and he would actually have chess playing competitions and stuff whenever they would get together for family times. And he just seemed like he was a really good down to earth boy next door kind of person. But yeah, I was 2.5 when he was killed. But I would say, and this is just my own homework, I would say I probably was around him around 8 months of my life, and the rest of it, he would have been overseas, whether it was in Thailand or Vietnam or training of some sort, whatever.
Now, he must have been a very patriotic and service-oriented person. He seeks to join the Air Force. He's in ROTC and graduates and gets his pilot's wings. What do you think drove him to want to serve in a combat capacity, you know, in Vietnam at this time?
I think he just wanted to do his part. Whether he agreed with the war itself or not, I don't know. I don't really care to know. It's not part of the story for me. But I think he just wanted to make America proud. He wanted to make sure that he did his part, and whatever he needed to do, he wanted to make sure he was a part of that. Whenever he and my mother met, they met in college and at USL, which is now ULL in Louisiana. But at the time it was USL. And they actually met because he was trying to cheat off of one of her papers in a class, and she caught him. And she, for a long time, refused to date him, but then finally did. So he wasn't all perfect. I actually enjoy getting to know the stories of when he was doing something wrong, because it makes him more human to me and less of a metal. But they met in college and dated there. And that was 1964 to 68. And then they did get married in September of 1968. But before he had taken her out to dinner, and he had the ring pulled out. My mother said people were just gasping and, oh, look how sweet. And they knew that they were about to witness a proposal. And before he proposed, he said, but before we do this, you need to know that it's God, country, family, and in that order. And if you're not okay with that, then we can't do this, you know? So that was not a very romantic way to propose, but, nonetheless, she accepted, and she understood from the very, very beginning that this was God, country, family, because without God, he didn't feel the country could be as wholesome and providing as he wanted it to be. And without that, he couldn't have a family be as safe and secure as he wanted them to be. So it was very clear to my mother that that was who he was. And there was zero doubt in her mind about that.
Well, that's a great story, and certainly gives us insights in terms of his service orientation. Mm-hmm. And as you know, Angela, and as I've read, he was first a B-52 pilot. So he's actually flying, the big, large strategic bombers out of Thailand, but then transitions to the OV-10 Bronco and mm-hmm. becomes a forward air controller, kind of a very different kind of mission. And he goes and requests a combat tour and is sent to Vietnam. This is, around 1972. Mike, I'm hoping this is roughly the time that you first meet Captain Bennett. Do you remember your first time that you met with him, or kind of recollections you have of him?
Yes, sir. It's kind of strange because sometimes the Marine and the Air Force don't exactly march to the same drummer. The Air Force had the OV-10 squadrons. There are two of them, 20th and 23rd tasks. And the Marines had already left country in 72. I was a captain stationed in Hawaii, and I'd been there over the country twice before. But as an infantry officer, I was also qualified as forward air controller, airborne, and naval gunfire spotter. In that big push of 72, when the North Vietnamese came south across the border, the U.S. Marines had left country, and the people taking the brunt of it were the South Vietnamese Marines, who had U.S. Marine advisors with them. So, and people supporting them were the OV-10 aircraft by the Air Force, but the Air Force had a couple of issues. One, they can't speak Marine. Two, they don't quite understand infantry tactics. So they had us coming temporary duty from Hawaii back flying with the Air Force, taking care of that from the back seat of the OV-10. And there were seven of us, seven Marines, and probably 100 Air Force pilots. You know how well we fit in. And some guys actually didn't like having another guy in the back seat, but Steve wasn't one of those. Steve and I had an understanding the first time we flew. I won't get into it, but we got it straightened out. But in the cockpit, he was probably one of the most professional pilots I've ever flown with. Strictly by the rules, doing everything exactly right the way it's supposed to be. And my job, he got us up there in the target area, and he could run airstrikes, I could run airstrikes. But I was a head of the naval gunfire deal and coordinated with the ground to make sure we didn't shoot them. So we worked well as a team. And I've flown with him a couple of times, probably three or four times, total time. So we got different pilots every time fly with. They're outnumbering us considerably. But I do the work with the ground, coordinate getting the Marines moved around so we can shoot naval gunfire for them and run airstrikes. But he was a superb pilot. If you want to fly with somebody, he's the guy you want on your front seat.
So, Mike, these OV-10 FAC missions, as you're kind of pointing out, weren't really supposed to be focused on, say, direct engagement of ground forces, but really you're calling in artillery or strikes to support ground forces. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And so you had been flying in theater, and in 1972, as you point out, this is a time of the Easter Offensive when the North Vietnamese Army is attacking the South Vietnamese forces. And so on June 29th, 1972, both of you take off in an OV-10 and you're flying over the Quang Tri area of Vietnam, from what I understand.
Yes, sir. We're just a little south of Quang Tri, but yes.
And was this a pretty typical mission for you at this time?
Fairly typical, because the coastline was where most of the contact with the North Vietnamese was going on. They basically came across Highway 1 and the DMZ and was storming down south trying to get to Way City. That's kind of where we were involved. And working on the coastline, we have access to naval gunfire, which is pretty handy for the South Vietnamese Marines. And that's my job, is, you know, keeping them separated and calling missions in from the destroyers and cruisers out in the ocean.
Now, I understand both of you have flown in OV-10 Broncos. I mean, this is a pretty iconic plane, very versatile plane. I mean, Mike, what was it like flying in an OV-10 over Vietnam? What was that plane like?
It was good. It kind of replaced the 01E, 01 Bird Dog, or Packer Cub, as most people call it. And it was a lot faster, a lot more agile, could carry armament. We carried 4M60 machine guns, two on each side of the aircraft, and we could also carry rocket pods for marking targets so we can run airstrikes. It was a great aircraft. It gave, as you've ever seen a picture of the aircraft, the canopy actually pulls out a little bit over to the side of the cockpit, and it gives you that observation capability, which you couldn't get in some of the other aircraft, and made it a super aircraft for its mission.
Fantastic. Sounds like a great plane for a forward air controller. And Angela, I understand you actually had a flight in an OV-10 as well.
I did, as a surprise. That was in 2019. I'm the president of the OV-10 Bronco Association. And so it's my job, it's all volunteer, but it's my job to put together the reunion for the OV-10 Bronco Association. It's a biannual reunion, and they brought an OV-10 that was in flying order and everything, and they surprised me with a ride in the back seat. So I was able to sit where Mike would have been and kind of get a feel for what it was like to be in that aircraft, and it was incredible. And my dad, I had found, it's just a certificate that they had in his record, and it was a Bronco Buster certificate. Mm-hmm. And so I found his, and then Jim Hodgson, who is the executive director at the museum, Fort Worth Aviation Museum, which is under the OV-10 Bronco Association, we're the parent company. He actually presented me with my own Bronco Buster. So it's actually hanging up on the wall in my staircase right there. I have a dual frame where my dad's is on top and then mine is underneath. So I can certainly provide a picture.
Oh, that's great.
I love that. Yeah. It was wonderful. I haven't stopped smiling about that yet.
Now, Mike, during the June 29th, 1972 mission, I understand that you and Captain Bennett had been flying for quite a number of hours. And then you receive this emergency call from ground forces kind of near Quang Tri. Do you remember that moment in the flight?
Yes, sir, very well. I think we launched around 1 o'clock in the afternoon. It was probably getting close to four. We got a call from, call sign was Harmony X-ray. It was Marine Captain Gary Dockendorf, advisor for the Marine Battalion. They had a platoon of about 40 people that had gone out a little too far and was working their way west, about to cross a gravel road. And there's a little creek that runs across that road and goes about 100 meters in force and Chalaka Y. And apparently they had about 300 North Vietnamese storming down that creek bed to take on those little 40 little Vietnamese Marines. And we had to help them out and get them back because they were a little too far out. So Steve called to see if there was any air on the station. There wasn't any, you know, bombing aircraft. I got naval gunfire online, but I couldn't shoot naval gunfire because they're what we call the gun target line, which is line between the ship and the target. They're right on the end of that line, so there's a very good chance we'd wind up hitting them. So there's nothing more we can do. And I'm still working with the Vietnamese Marines on the ground. I've got them, they've got air panels out where I can see them from the airplane, just trying to get them back to friendly lines. But it's getting kind of obvious that they're just about to get overrun. So I told Steve, said, we got to run. We got to make gun runs on these guys. That's the only thing we've got. And the general rule was back then, in the OV-10, you don't make gun runs unless it's a search and rescue situation, although it didn't really classify one as such, because the OV-10 down below at certain levels is very susceptible to SAM-7 missiles, the handheld missiles. And I told Steve, said, this is the only thing we can do to save these guys. We got to do something. I said, get on the line, get on the net, find out whatever. As far as I'm concerned, we're going in. And a few seconds later, he came back and said, okay, we're going in. And to this day, I never know if he got authorization to do it or not, but we went in. So we're making long gun runs, and another airplane joined up another OV-10 joined up with us. So we're making gun runs along the creek bed, banking left and right. And we had taken a couple of SAM-7s and shot at us, but missed. But about the fourth pass, we were pulling out and banking hard left, and I was leaning over, looking back, seeing what kind of damage we're doing. And I just sat back in my seat, and the missile hit our left engine. You got an exhaust pipe on the outboard side of your left engine, and that's a heat seeker missile. And it went right in there and just blew the engine apart. And I got to travel through my back of my canopy. Some of the travel went through my left side of my canopy and out Steve's right side, and neither one was hit. I had some minor shrapnel wounds on my shoulder and my arm. And then the left landing gear is hung up inside underneath the engine, but it's now hanging to drop down like a wounded bird. So we had, but the plane was still flyable. We're both standing on the rudder because you got the right engine pulling, the left engine isn't. And so we're flying kind of semi-sideways, trying to get back to the water and get out and make it back to Da Nang. We had to get to Da Nang to land, although Hue City was closer. They didn't have foam capability on runway with that gear down. We had to have foam capability to put it down. So we're back over the coastline about 300 meters off the beach, heading south. And the other OV-10 joined alongside us with Captain Darrell Whitcomb. And we're flying alongside it. And then the fire started up in the wing again. That's where the fuel was stored in the wing. He says, you got to get out of it. You got to get out of it. We're getting ready to eject. And I look back, and there's a big hole right behind my seat. And I look back, and I see silk pieces floating around back there, which is not a good sign. We're getting ready to eject. So, you know, I had parachute damage. And he said, I think Darrell said he could see what through the hole in the aircraft. He could see Hue City through the hole in the aircraft on the other side. So I'm a Marine infantry officer by trade. I can fly the aircraft and do all that kind of stuff. I never knew that, because it had such a great ejection system, we never thought about putting the plane in the water. You know, just it was such a good aircraft. But the Air Force knew it. I didn't. So you don't put a Bronco in the water because it's going to break up. But we had no other choice. Now, in a Bronco, you have a two-seat ejection system. The back seat can eject itself. After the front seat ejected, automatically throws the back seat out first, because his rocket motor will fry the back seat if he doesn't go first. So he couldn't punch out, although he was not wounded. I had no other choice, and he realized, and I didn't at the time, that no one's ever survived a water ejection with an OV-10 aircraft. He decided he wanted to put it in the water. There's no other choice. It's interesting at this point, because we probably knew 10, maybe 15 minutes in advance. He did anyway. He probably was going to make it out of the aircraft, but I might have a chance to escape. So we hit the water, left landing gear caught first, and the plane swung to the right, roll wing over wing, and stop, nose down, inverted, totally underwater. Not one of these deals where you wait till the water gets up to here. We just totally submerged. I had some difficulty getting out of my seat because my coat fitting hung up. I finally got out of that. Got out. I didn't know which way was up, but the bubbles were going that way. So I just kind of paddled that way, got to the top. We're about 300 meters off the beach, and this was half cowboy, half Indian country. There's about maybe 6 feet of tail boom sticking up out of the water. And I couldn't find Steve, so I swam around trying to get back. An airplane was slowly sinking. I'm trying to get to the cockpit to get to Steve, I made three or four dives and finally, and I couldn't reach the front end of the cockpit. The plane finally sank. And it set, the bottom line was about 60 feet. So that's where the plane settled. I got back to the top. I look and I see sampans, which are basically canoes coming out from the beach. And I don't know if these guys are good guys or bad guys, but one of them had an AK-47. So that gives me a hint. So I pull my 45 out. I haven't inflated my water, my life jacket yet, because you have enough natural buoyancy to stay afloat for a little bit before you do that. And I shot at the guy. And I don't know if it hit him or not. He went out of the boat, and I heard this. I dove back underwater. Thought they had machine guns on me. One of it wasn't them. It was the other OV-10 that rolled. As soon as we saw him, we rolled through a line down between them and me, and they went back to the beach. And so later on, a few minutes later, I didn't inflate my water wings because of my survival vest, because when it brings you up higher out of the water, it makes you a nice red target. And I didn't want to do that. So this helicopter came down the beach from the USS Tripoli, and they saw us. They're going to get the mail to Da Nang. They saw this flaming OV-10 going down the beach, and they came out and they picked me up and took me back to the Tripoli, USS Tripoli. And I got back to Da Nang the next day or the day after. And as soon as I got off the airplane, the squadron commander, Colonel Cardon, who was a great officer to work with, he liked the Marines. But, he wanted to see me immediately, which I can understand that. I went back to a debriefing with him and a couple other officers and communications people. He won't know what happened exactly, obviously, because he's a squadron commander, but he just lost an airplane and a damn good pilot. So I walked him through the mission and told him what happened. I said, who gave you permission to make the gun run? I said, I don't know. It could have been Trail, which is my controller, or Big, the Air Force controller. I don't know. And sir, I don't really care, sir. and he came back and didn't say anything more. And then later on, we're working up, the SEAL team went there next day and got Steve's body out of the aircraft. And apparently the cockpit had separated just in front of me, about 30 degrees off to the right. Apparently he had gotten out of the cockpit. They said he suffered some significant head wounds. Well, he wasn't wounded before he went in, because I could see in his mirrors on the canopy boat that, you know, he wasn't wounded. So apparently when we hit, because I know the cockpit separated in front of me, either his harness broke and it either hit the console, or maybe the gun sight was hanging from the canopy bolt. Anyway, apparently, and they still don't know this day if he died of his wounds or if he drowned. And I told him, and he was a swimmer too. At that point, swimming doesn't make much difference down where we were. That still bothers me to this day. I couldn't get down to the front of the cockpit, his late mother, her wife, still doesn't know how he died. And some people, he got some stories, some hypothetical stories from some people. And I first met her back in 88. I took her, and I think Angela was in junior in high school. I explained to her.
I was a senior.
Explained to her exactly how the mission went down. That's the first time she'd ever heard that. So she didn't like it, but she's glad she heard what happened. So anyway, working with a Captain Rich Poling, the awards officer of a squadron, riding the award up for Steve. And we're talking about this. And they're talking Air Force Cross. We start talking about some more. And I said, and then when I found out about, what he did, really impacted my surviving. I said, oh, wait a minute. He knew full well in advance, probably 10 or 15 minutes before going in, that he's probably going to get killed, but I might have a chance. And he did that. And that's about as brave as you can get. They bought him bought out the next day, I guess it was there later. And then after getting all the documentation together, with Captain Doc and Dort, the advisor on the ground with the Vietnamese Marines, we finally got it. Finally got the Medal of Honor.
Well, Mike, that's a powerful account. And I think, it's at the very heart of Captain Bennett's citation. And, the fact that you're able to be with us today and speak and share that account is due to a lot of that sacrifice. But as I've learned from both of you too, as we learn about the mission itself and kind of the original reason for the ground attacks, is you also helped save the South Vietnamese Marines and the Marine Advisor, from what I understand.
Yes, sir.
So
they all made it back.
There's two groups of people who, you know, were alive today because of the actions taken on June 29th, 1972. When you reflect back on kind of the mission in its totality, I mean, what are some of the things that you hope Americans really appreciate about that mission and what you were doing?
Well, I'm a big believer that the South Vietnamese are trying to keep their country and avoid becoming communists. And I've agreed that, you know, the communists are taking over everything, that they shouldn't be there. I was a big believer in what we were doing there. I was not a very big believer in how they let us do it. We were too much politically controlled, and they wouldn't let us, they give us a mission. Let us complete the mission. Don't nickel dime us to death, you know, how we're doing it. But that was my third tour in Vietnam. And when I came back, got back to Hawaii 3 months later, I was given some serious thought about getting out of the Marine Corps. At that point, I had about 10 years in. But I decided, no, this is what I want to do. But and again, you see these wars now where they over control the people in the field, give the people in the field a mission, let them do their job and leave them alone. So we don't see that much anymore.
And Mike, well, for what I've read too, you know, the actions of the forward air controllers, the naval gunfire support, the airstrikes that are all happening in 1972 played a critical role towards defeating the North Vietnamese Army in that Easter offensive, and they took enormous casualties. And so while we know that the Vietnam War ends in a communist victory, unfortunately, at least in 1972, even though there's very few Americans like yourself serving, you're playing an enormous and critical role in terms of defending the South Vietnamese.
Yes, sir. We didn't, the military people didn't lose the war. The politicians lost the war. We won it.
Now, Captain Bennett's Medal of Honor application is approved, and he will become one of the few Air Force Medal of Honor recipients. There's 19 as of today. Angela, you are there in Washington, D.C. on August 8th. 1974 for a Medal of Honor ceremony in which your father, who's now departed, is going to receive the Medal of Honor, a posthumous Medal of Honor. I know that you're still at a very early age, but I've seen some photographs of you there and it looks like you had quite a time meeting Vice President Ford. I wonder if you could kind of share a little bit about that day and the memories of it.
Sure. I don't really remember much of the day. I remember it through the stories that I've been told and through the pictures that we have. The main picture, so at the Fort Worth Aviation Museum, I leave one of the Medal of Honor photo albums there. And the docents that we have like to tell the story of when President Ford stepped on my foot. So there's two pictures that I'll be able to share with you with regard to that story. And one of them is I was 4 years old and I was tracing the brick with my feet. I didn't really understand why we were there. It was just a lot of people there. And I was probably nervous and bored at the same time. So I was tracing the brick with my feet and President Ford is behind me. And I stopped. And when I stopped, he stepped on my foot. And then as if you fast forward a little bit, the officer that was there with President Ford was handing him the Medal of Honor to give to my mother. So that's the picture. And so President Ford is reaching out to grab the Medal of Honor to hand it to my mother. And then he's looking straight down at his foot. And in the picture, you look at the ground and I'm stepping on his foot. So I got him back, and Rich Poling, who has recently passed away, but Rich Poling was a family friend of ours, and he told me a long time ago, he said, Angela, do you know what the president said at that time? And I said, no, I don't remember. And he said, President Ford looked down and he said, young lady, you're stepping on my foot. And without skipping a beat, I looked up at President Ford and I said, well, you stepped on mine first. So that's my claim to fame. I stepped on President Ford's foot. And then we do have the picture of President Ford presenting the Medal of Honor to my mother and to myself. And so he's kind of bending over so that it's more my eye range. So they're holding it at my level. That picture is the one that's used the most. And I can absolutely supply that picture as well.
Thank you. And Angela, I understand that you have that Medal of Honor with you right now.
It's right next to Mike.
There it is.
There it is.
So Angela, that is the Medal of Honor that Vice President Ford presented to your family, which is a powerful symbol. And for those that don't know, posthumous Medals of Honor around this time and all the way up to current times were always presented cased. They weren't presented kind of as around your neck if you were a living recipient. So that's wonderful to see that piece of history and to see that Medal of Honor. Mike, were you there at the ceremony too?
No, sir. I was in the process of being assigned to Inspector Instructor Staff in Akron, Ohio, and there's a big miscommunication between the Marine Corps and the Air Force and that. So I found later I was invited, and I was told from the Marine Corps side I wasn't supposed to be there. So no, I done missed that.
And Angela, you know, you have played a really key role in keeping your father's memory alive. And I wonder if you kind of share with us kind of some of the efforts that you've undertaken to better understand your father's actions and what you do even today.
I talk to anybody and everybody that'll listen. And I do that so that I can get the information I need to fill in the different holes that I have. And I also do it so that they can learn. The Medal of Honor is with me at all times, but when I do go to the museum and volunteer, which is usually on Saturday mornings, I'll take it with me to the museum and put it on display so that people can see it, because I truly believe that it's worthless if it's not being shared. I want my dad's death to mean something, and I want it to be something that everybody can be proud of. And I think in order for that to happen, they need to know his story, and they need to know the story of everybody else that Medal of Honor or not has given and sacrificed for this country. So it's very important to me that I share his story with anybody that'll listen. I've spoken at elementary schools, at high schools. We go to a variety of memorials and dedications. Out of state, in state, it doesn't matter. If I'm asked to go somewhere, more than likely I'm going to be there unless I just cannot make it for some reason. But I've met people along the way. Facebook has been huge in meeting people. I've met men who served with him and were friends of his while in Da Nang. The only group of people I've not been able to find is, well, there's two. One, I haven't found the ground unit that was on the ground that day. I'd love to talk to one of them. And then people who served with him during his time as a B-52 co-pilot. I've not reached anybody in that unit. So those are holes for me. And it's important for me to get that story. So, you know, maybe even through things like this, that's one of the reasons that I do these things, is to put the story out there, to let people know that I'm fully accessible. I am very easy to be found. and, you know, I always welcome a conversation about it. I think that the men that served, and women now, the men and women who serve in our military deserve the utmost respect. The reason that we're sitting here in air-conditioned homes with the ability to go to work or not go to work, go get a Coke, go to the movies, do whatever it is that we want to do, is 100% because of their support and sacrifices. And I think that people have lost sight of that, and it's very disheartening to me. I don't care what side of the political aisle people are on. I care that they support our troops and support our country. So I do everything I can to make sure that that happens.
And Mike, it's been 50 years since this mission, and I know you shared a lot about the particulars of the mission, but when you reflect back now 50 years and you think about Steve Bennett and kind of what happened on that day, what are some of the things you want, you know, Americans to remember most?
Well, people that, if I may back up a little bit, and I've told Angela this before, I've had the honor of serving with several Medal of Honor recipients. If there's one common thread amongst them, one are all very humble people and very brave people. But a lot of times you hear that the Medal of Honor received, a man immediately threw himself on a grenade or did this. It was just instantaneous. Steve Bennett knew probably 15 minutes in advance what was going to happen, and he kept going. I didn't know that, but that's about as brave as you can get.
I want to thank you both for sharing your memories of Captain Bennett. It's a story that's 50 years old today, but one that we want to carry on into the years ahead for all Americans to be deeply inspired by. So thank you for sharing those memories, and thank you, Major Brown, for your service, and Angela, for all that you're doing to keep the memory alive. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you for doing this. We appreciate it.